Hello and welcome to this next lecture in the course on pattern recognition. We have been discussing issues of statistical learning theory. Specifically, we are looking at the so-called Wapnick-Chernenkis theory. We have been looking at the problem of when is empirical risk minimization consistent. So we looked at the empirical risk minimization framework. We have considered the actual formalism, and then we were discussing how can one put some bound on the generalization errors that learning algorithms make, or which is same as saying if the algorithm minimizes empirical risk, is it good enough for us? Can we have confidence that what we learnt is good in the sense that it is close to the global minimizer of true risk, right? So let's so we have been considering the question of how to address the generalization abilities of a learning algorithm. How does one quantify it? So we have discussed the formalism of risk minimization. So essentially, we are given an input space X, which is the feature space, and we are looking for example, in the simplest case, two class classifiers on X, that is 0, 1 valued functions defined on X. And the way we evaluate any learned function is through through a loss function, and we have defined the risk at the expectation of loss with respect to the same probability distribution that the examples are given to us. And any learning algorithm, as we saw, essentially minimizes the empirical risk. Okay. But what we actually want is the minimizer of the true risk. The true risk of any function h is expected value of L of hx comma y, where expectation with respect to the joint distribution of x, y, the same distribution with respect to which we get our examples. We do not know the distribution, hence we cannot minimize the true risk. Since we have IID examples, we can approximate the true risk by the by its sample mean estimator, which is called the empirical risk. And empirical risk is what most learning algorithms can minimize. And hence the question is, when does a minimizer of empirical risk well approximate the minimizer of true risk? That is what we have been discussing. And when we say approximate, we do not want the functions to be closed as functions, the classifiers to be closed as functions on X, but that their true risk should be closed, because a classifier for us is evaluated only in terms of its risk. So what we actually want is, if H star is a global minimizer of R, then R H star is the global minimum of true risk, and H hat star N is the minimizer of the empirical risk. Given n examples, this is the minimizer of the empirical risk, the global minimizer of the empirical risk. So you are asking, if the risk of what I can learn is the minimizer of the empirical risk. So what you are asking is, the risk of what I can learn, is it close to the global minimum of risk? So is what I learn as a classifier is close to the best? So what we want to achieve is that, given any epsilon and delta, we can put a bound on the number of examples we need, so that if we see in that many examples, that many IID examples, and minimize the empirical risk, then the true risk of the minimizer of the empirical risk is close to the global minimum achievable on true risk. Okay. This is what we want to show. And we have been, for the last two classes, we have looked at the analysis of this, and we saw that this is possible if this R hat and H, the empirical risk of any function, any classifier H, converges to R H, the true risk of the classifier, uniformly over H, which is the family of classifiers over which you are searching for the minimizer of the empirical risk. Okay. As we see, in such a uniform convergence is sufficient to ensure this, and we also stated that it is necessary to ensure this. Right. So ultimately, the question, see, we know that R hat and H, which is the sample mean estimator of R H, and hence R hat and H converges to R H as n tends to infinity, that is the law of large numbers. But as you saw, that is not enough. What we actually need is that this convergence given by the law of large numbers, that r hat and h, the sample mean estimator, converges to r h, the expected value, uniformly over h. And we also the uniform convergence means the following, that given any epsilon delta, there is one number n epsilon delta, and if I have that many examples, then for every h in my family, r hat n h is close to r h. Right? Normally, the law of large number convergence only ensures that given any specific h, I can tell you how many examples I need, so that r hat n h is close to r h. The uniform convergence means that the same number of examples would work for every single h in this family h. Right? That's why probability supremum of the difference r hat n h minus r h, where the supremum is taken over the family of classifiers h, script h. This supremum difference being greater than epsilon should be less than delta. Okay? This is what uniform convergence means. Okay? We also saw that this is show the uniform convergence holds if the class of classifiers H has a finite VC dimension. Okay. Now, we actually showed that, to recall, what we showed is that the probability of the supremum difference between r hat and h minus r h greater than epsilon, where the supremum is taken over the family of classifiers, can be bounded above by this. And where this m h to n, right, is the maximum number of distinguishable functions in h based on all possible sample sets. What we actually have for r hat n h here, we actually have here m h comma 2 n, but for any integer m, m h comma m is the maximum number of distinguishable functions in h, based on all possible MIID examples. Given MIID examples, any two functions that take the same values on those examples are indistinguishable as far as the sample is concerned. So, considering that way, we are asking, if I choose every possible set of MIID examples, every possible set of M examples, because you're choosing every possible set IID makes no difference. So, for every possible set of IID examples, every possible set of M examples, among all, if we consider all possible sets of M examples, we are asking what is the maximum number of distinguishable functions in H. Okay. So, there would be some set of M examples on which this maximum would be reached. Okay. So, we are asking, if I look at every possible M set of examples, what is the maximum possible number of functions within H that I can distinguish. Now, looking at this bound, essentially we want this bound to be made as small as we want as n tends to infinity. This term is decreasing linearly in n. So, the question is, how does this grow with n? If m h comma m grows exponentially with m, then the logarithm will grow linearly with n here. Then obviously, inside the exponent, there is one term that decreases linearly with n, another term increases linearly with n. So, we can say nothing about whether it will go to 0. On the other hand, if the logarithm of m h comma 2 n does not grows less than linearly, or it does not grow linearly or grows less than linearly with n, then with sufficiently large n, we can make this as small as we want, and hence we get the uniform convergence. So, ultimately, whether or not uniform convergence holds depends on this particular quantity, how it grows with m. Okay. As we stated last class, we can bound this quantity. Basically, in this, we want to bound ln m h comma 2 n. So, if we call that quantity some g h of m, then one can show, or Wapnick and Chen Wenkins have actually shown in a very important work in machine learning, they have shown that this function g h m has only two possible growth patterns. There will be some integer which we call d v c of h, standing for v c dimension of h, which could be, for example, infinity, as long as m is less than or equal to dv sub h, this grows as m ln 2. That means capital M, that h comma m, what is inside this logarithm, that grows as 2 power m, right, exponentially. But after this dv sub h is reached, when m grows beyond that, ln of capital M grows only L, which means that capital M h comma m, that the maximum number of distinguishable functions, that grows does not grow exponentially, that grows less than exponentially. Okay, it essentially grows as so this is ln of this, that grows essentially as ln of m, right, with some factor here. So because it grows as ln of m, what it means is that here the dependence with respect to n will come as ln of 2n. So this term grows only logarithmically in n, whereas this term decreases linearly in n. So ultimately this dominates. So as n increases, what is inside the exponent increases, and hence the right hand side can be made as small as you want. So, because this GHM has only these two possible growth patterns, right, what it means is that if this number dv sub h, which is a characterizing number for the family of classifiers h, if that number is less than infinity, then there is some finite m beyond which the growth of GHM is only logarithmic, and hence uniform convergence holds, right. So, this dv sub h is called VC dimension of h, and hence if VC dimension of h is less than infinity, then we have a proper bound, right. If VC dimension of h is less than infinity, then after some m, ln of capital M is only grows logarithmically, which means as I have just told you, the second time this exponent grows only as ln of m, ln of n, whereas this decreases as n, linearly in n. So, as n goes to infinity, this exponent goes to 0. Okay. So, if the VC dimension of h is less than infinity, then we have a proper bound and consistency of ERM is assured. So, we started the question of consistency of empirical risk. We said that if there is uniform convergence of empirical averages to the true expectations uniformly over h, then ERM is consistent. And this in turn, this uniform convergence in turn holds if the VC dimension of h is less than infinity. Okay. Now, to get a good appreciation of what we mean by this VC dimension, m h comma capital M of h comma small m is the maximum number of distinguishable functions based on all possible m sets of examples, all possible example sets of size m. What the previous result that we just now saw says is that this number is equal to 2 power m only as long as m is less than the VC dimension of h. Once m is more than VC dimension of h, this grows less than exponentially, and hence we can bound the generalization error. Okay. That's how the VC dimension works. So, till VC dimension, the maximum possible number of distinguishable functions will grow exponentially, but after that the growth is less than exponential, and hence our generalization bound works. Okay. Of course, this only shows that if VC dimension less than infinity, ERM is consistent, because it is only a bound. If it is equal to infinity, we do not know, we could bound some other way, but it can be shown that if VC dimension is infinity, then we cannot bound the generalization error. So, now the question is, how do we find the VC dimension of H? So, ultimately, given a family of classifiers or which you want to search, let us say hyperplane classifiers, let us say axis parallel rectangles, whatever particular class of classifiers or which you are minimizing empirical risk, given that H, first thing we want to know is whether the VC dimension is less than infinity. So, one question we would like to know is, given a H, how does one find VC dimension? Okay. We will see that, but Before we go there, we first examine, given that there is a finite VC dimension, exactly what will be the generalization error bound, or rather the uniform convergence bound, using which we derive a very interesting bound on the risk of any classifier, which is also useful in its own right. Okay. So, what we are going to first see is how we can actually bound the risk of any classifier using VC dimension, and that allows us to appreciate how the complexity of the family of classifiers grows. We need more examples. Okay. So, essentially this bond allows us to appreciate that VC dimension is a measure of complexity of the learning problem. So, let us once again get back to the bond. See, for the uniform convergence, this is the bond we have. Right. Now, basically we want to show that if n is large enough, this can be made less than any delta we want. Okay. So, let us say we given a delta, we want to make that less than delta, right. This is our bond. So, we want to make this less than delta. So, given a particular delta, we want to make this less than delta. Of course, using this equation, for a given epsilon, we can say how large n should be, so it is less than delta, or for a given n, very often that is what we have, we know how many examples we have. I can say what is the worst case epsilon that I get. So, I can solve this equation for epsilon, that will tell me if I have n examples and I want to make some statement with probability greater than 1 minus delta, what is the epsilon, right. So, this comes from the, so if this is less than delta, what it means is that with probability greater than 1 minus delta, I can say that r hat and h is epsilon close to r h, the difference between them is at most epsilon. So, using this, I can now compute a given an n, I can compute an epsilon, so that I can make the statement. So, let us invert this for solving for epsilon. So, I can take 8 on this side, it become delta by 8, take logs on both sides, then I get minus n epsilon squared by 8 plus ln of this is less than ln of delta by 8, bring that this side and n epsilon squared that side, minus ln delta by 8 is ln 8 by delta. So, I get ln 8 by delta plus this logarithmic term, that should be less than n epsilon squared by 8. So, the worst case epsilon would be 8 by n into this square root of. Okay. So, if I am given n examples with probability 1 minus delta, r hat n h is epsilon not close to r h, right. It cannot be more than epsilon away from r h. That statement I can make with probability 1 minus delta. So, let us make that statement and see what it means. So, the way we calculated this epsilon naught, we can say that given that delta, with probability at least 1 minus delta, I know that for every h in my family, r hat n h is at most epsilon away from r h, right. Which means with probability greater than 1 minus delta, for every single h, r hat h, r of h, the true risk of h is at most r hat n h plus this epsilon. I know r hat n h is epsilon close to r h. So, what the worst case true risk I can have? For every h, the true risk of h is bounded above by the empirical risk I actually calculated using n examples plus this term. Okay? Because I can say with probability 1 minus delta, at least 1 minus delta, for every h, r hat n h is epsilon naught close to r h, which means r h can be at most r hat n h plus epsilon. It cannot be more than that. So, r h is less than or equal to r hat n h plus epsilon naught, and this is epsilon naught. Okay. Now, let us assume that we have a finite VC dimension and hence substitute for this logarithmic term here in terms of VC dimension. Okay. So, when VC dimension is finite and n is sufficiently large, right, this is this, I am sorry, this m should be 2n here. Okay, I'm sorry about that. So, this is the bound that we saw earlier in that Wapnick-Hermann-Quist theorem. So, let us substitute that. So, I can say RH, the true risk of any classifier H is bounded above by its empirical risk, which I can calculate from my samples, plus this term. In this term, if I take this n inside the brackets, it becomes dVC H by n. So, dvch by n decreases with n, this increases with n, but this increases only logarithmically in n by dvch and this decreases linearly in terms of dvc by h. So as n increases, because logarithm grows slowly, right, this growth is more than compensated by this decrease of this term. So the term in the square root can be made very small if n is sufficiently larger than dvc of h. So if n is much larger than dvc of h, the dvc h by n term, right, more than compensates for this term. Okay. In particular, as n tends to infinity, this term goes to 0. So r hat n h will become same as r h. Okay. That is what uniform convergence is. But at any given n, how small this term is depends on how large is dvc by h. Okay. What does that mean? Firstly, before we can ask what that means, we can make many conclusions, but before we get carried away, let us understand that the bound is very loose, the bound we obtain is very loose. If you remember, we started first with a Hofding bound, which is distribution independent, which has to hold for every possible kind of distribution, and hence it cannot be very tight on any specific distribution. Then we used a union bound. Union bound means we have many sets a1, a2, an, probability of union, we bound above some of the individual probabilities, that is also a loose bound very often. On top of that, we needed to find the expected value of the number of distinguishable functions, because we cannot find the expected value, we bounded that by the maximum value of the number of distinguishable functions. So every step of the way, we threw in very loose bounds. So the final bound we get must be very loose, right. So numerically the bound may not be very useful, but what is interesting is the form of the bound. Okay. The form of the bound we can put on R H gives us some very interesting ideas. Okay. We can write the bound as R H is less than or equal to R hat n H plus some term, we call it omega H comma n. What distinguishes this omega H comma n is that this term, as you can see, does not depend on my sample. See, R at n h depends on the sample, this actual sample on which what is the error or what is the average loss that my h makes. But this second term does not depend on the sample, it only depends on the class of families over which I am searching for minimizer empirical risk and the number of examples I have. So it is something that characterizes the complexity of the class of classifiers from which I am learning. Right. So I can write this as R H less than R hat n H plus some term that depends on n on the family of classifiers, but not on the specific sample set that I have. So I can write it like this, where omega is a complexity term. So this is the data error, as we already seen when we looked at regularized least squares. This is the data error, this is the actual error or loss that H suffers on the data. This tells me lack of fit between H of X, Xi and Yi, average row or all Xi Yi, which are my samples. Whereas this is a complexity term, right? It only depends on the class of classifiers on which I am searching and the number of examples I have. So, two risk H depends both on the data error, right? So, even if my data error is very small, it does not mean that my two risk is very small, because this term can be large. So, the true risk depends both on the data error and the model complexity. This depends on how complex it is, the model is. So, of course, I know that this term goes to 0 as n tends to infinity, but how large n should be for this term to be sufficiently small depends on what is the complexity of h. Right? So, the complexity term goes to 0 as dvc h divided by n. Right? So, if n is much larger than the vc dimension of h, that is when the complexity term goes to 0, right. It means we need large number of examples to believe the data error. When this term is sufficiently small, then small error on the examples will also mean that small true error. So, its real generalization error, which is the true risk, will also be small if its empirical risk is small. So, the data error is a good indicator of what its generalization error would be. if this term is small, and this term will be small if n is sufficiently large. How large is large? How large is large is depends on the VC dimension. So, n should be large relative to the VC dimension of H. So, it is in this sense that VC dimension tells us about the complexity of the class of classifiers from which I am learning. So, how many examples I need? I need examples which are much larger than VC dimension of H. So, for different H, how large n should be before I can believe my data error depends on how complex H is. If H is complex, meaning H has very high VC dimension, then the same number of examples will not give me the same amount of confidence that my data error is a true reflection of the true error of the classifier. Okay. So, let us sum this up. We minimize empirical risk over H, a chosen family of classifiers. Okay. We choose a family of classifiers H, and then on that we are minimizing empirical risk. That is my essentially minimizing the data error. If the VC dimension of H is infinite, of course, all bets are off. We can say nothing about whether the minimize of the empirical risk will get us anywhere. Okay. The minimize of empirical risk is not effective if VC dimension of H is infinite. So, that is one thing that we have to anyway ensure. So, unless VC dimension of H is finite, minimization of empirical risk is not an effective learning strategy. Okay. When VC dimension of H is less than infinity, we have chosen a class H that says VC dimension of H is less than infinity, then R hat and H converges to R H uniformly over H. And this means that with a large, if I am giving sufficiently large number of examples, minimization of empirical risk would have low true risk also. Right? So, the global minimization of the empirical risk will be close to the global minimum of true risk. Okay. So, if VC dimension is less than infinity, given sufficiently large number of examples, at least learning is possible. The second point is how large is large for number of examples. True risk is bounded above by empirical risk plus a complexity term as we just saw, and the complexity term goes to 0 as VC dimension of H divided by n. So, higher the VC dimension, higher is the number of examples needed before I can say good performance on the examples means good performance on unseen data. Intuitive way of saying is that if I solve only one exercise problem and got it right, I cannot have much confidence that I will do well in the test. But if I solve hundreds of exercise problems and got them right, then I think I can have sufficient confidence that I will do well in the test. Right? That is all it means. And of course, how many examples I have to solve depends on how complex is the concept I am trying to learn. So, here we are learning a classifier. So, higher the VC dimension, higher is the number of examples needed, and it is in this sense that VC dimension tells you the complexity of learning with H. So, not only VC dimension tells me whether empirical risk minimization will be effective or not, that is a binary question. So, if VC dimension is less than infinity, empirical risk minimization would be effective, that is good to know and that is important. But that is not the whole story. The VC dimension of H as a number will also tell me how complex is the class of classifiers from which I am trying to learn this. It tells me in the sense that for me to learn well, that is for me to be confident that low error on the data set will mean low error on test set also. What I need is that the number of examples should be large relative to the VC dimension. While this bound is rather loose, a rule of thumb most often used in machine learning community is that the number of examples should be at least 10 times VC dimension, because I have VC dimension H by n multiplied by log of n by VC dimension H. So, if there is a factor of 10, the increase because of log term will be more than compensated by the decrease in VC dimension of H by n. Okay. So, roughly 10 times VC dimension is a good thumb rule, and it is in this sense that higher the VC dimension, more complex is the learning problem. Okay. Okay. Having appreciated VC dimension for what it is, let us ask how do we find VC dimension. Okay. Let us remember that we have done all this only for two class classifiers. Right? This entire analysis we have done for where the hypothesis space H contains functions which are binary valued functions over my input space. Right? Okay. So, VC dimension is tied to the growth rate of this quantity. Right? Now, what is this quantity? This quantity is the maximum number of distinguishable functions that I can pick from my class of functions H based on all possible samples of m points from my input set, from my input space, right, from my feature space. We know that this number, the maximum possible number of distinguishable functions from H, grows exponentially as 2 power m only as long as m is less than or equal to BC dimension of H, right. So, given a set of m points in X, any specific set of m points in X, how many different ways I can assign class labels to them? The 2 power m ways of assigning labels 0 or 1 to them, right. Because I am considering all the functions in my hypothesis space H are binary valued functions, right. Each function can take only value 0 or 1. Given any m points in X, there are 2 power m different ways of assigning zeros and ones to those m points. That means, anyway, the maximum number of distinguishable functions is always 2 power m. There cannot be more than 2 power m distinguishable functions anyway given m points, right. So, the question is, the maximum number of distinguishable functions will be 2 power m if every possible labeling is realized by some function or the other, right. So, given a set of m points, I can label it in 2 power m ways. For each labeling, if there is a function h which exactly realizes that labeling, meaning that function h takes exactly those values 0s and 1s on those m points, then I know the maximum number of possible functions will be 2 power m, right. So, maximum number of distinguishable functions will be 2 power m if given m points, if I label them on all possible ways. For every such labeling, there is some function in H that with respect to which that labeling is consistent. That's what this quantity is. The maximum number of distinguishable functions is nothing but if I take m points and keep labeling them with zeros and ones, there are 2 power m ways of doing it. For every such labeling, if there is one function in H that realizes that labeling, then there will be total of at least 2 power m, there will be a total of 2 power m distinguishable functions, ok. So, we will use this to get a more usable definition of BC dimension, ok. So, how do we go about this? Before we do that, let me re-emphasize, we are defining all this only for 2 class classification problems. That is, for us, the hypothesis space H consists of set of functions H, where each function maps my input space script X with the feature space to 0, 1, right. So, we are considering only 2 class classification problems, where what we call the action space is same as the class labels. We are only considering binary valued functions on X. If my H is that kind of a family, we are trying to ask what is the BC dimension. To define BC dimension, we define the concept of what is called shattering. We will say a set A, which is a subset of my input space X, is said to be shattered by the family of functions H. Let me emphasize, the concept of shattering is a property of subsets of my input space, right? That nothing to do with labels, nothing to do with underlying probability distribution, nothing. It is a property of subsets of X and also of the family of classifiers that I am considering. So, given a particular subset of X, it is said to be shattered by the family of classifiers H if the following holds. So, given any set A which is subset of X, I will say it is shattered by H if you give me any subset B of A, for every subset B of A, there is a function in my family of functions, which of course will depend on B, such that function H will take value 1 for all points in B and take value 0 for all points in A minus B. I do not care what it takes outside A, but this set A is shattered if for every subset B of A, there is a function in my family such that function takes value 1 for all points inside that set B and takes value 0 in the rest of the points, that is in the points A but not in B, ok. This is what this is when I say A is shattered by H. If A is an m point set that is shattered, what does that mean? See, every possible subset, how many possible subsets of B are there, subsets of A are there? If A is m point, there are 2 power m possible subsets. Why? choosing a subset of A is same as putting a particular labeling of zeros and ones on elements of A, right. So choosing, giving a subset of A simply says, okay, these elements of A are in the subset, these elements of A are not in the subset, which means a subset is characterized by the so called characteristic function, which is simply a way of labeling the elements of A by zeros and ones. Those that are labeled by 1 are in the subset, those that are labeled by 0 not in the subset. Now, for every possible subset, there is a function that exactly realizes that ones and zeros, which means if A is an m point set and I label the points of A in all possible ways with zeros and 1, there are 2 power m possible labeling. For every single labeling, will be a subset of A. Every single labeling, there is a H that realizes that labeling, because that H takes value 1 for points in B, 0 for points in A minus B. So, an m point set is shattered, then for every one of the 2 power m possible labelings of points in A, there is a function to realize that labeling. That means, here is an m point set for which the number of distinguishable functions is 2 power m. So, which means, because if I can find at least one m point set such that the number of distinguishable functions is 2 power m, and I know number of distinguishable functions cannot be more than 2 power m, we know the maximum number of distinguishable functions is 2 power m. So, if an m point set is shattered, then we know for that m the maximum number of distinguishable functions will be 2 power m, alright. So, this tells us how we can define the VC dimension. What is VC dimension? The maximum value of M till which this is true, the maximum number of maximum possible number of functions is 2 power M, right. VC dimension is that value of this integer such that the maximum number of possible functions is 2 power M, which means VC dimension is nothing but the cardinality of the largest shattered subset of X, right. So, we can define VC dimension of H as the cardinality of the largest shattered subset of X, okay. Of course, when I say largest, essentially we are considering finite sets. So, if for every integer m there is a m point subset of X that is shattered, then VC dimension is infinite. So, if for every integer m there is an m point subset that is shattered, then VC dimension is infinite. Otherwise, VC dimension is the cardinality of the largest shattered subset of X. Also remember that if I found one m point subset of H that is shattered, then if I take any subset of that set, that is also shattered, obviously, because if every possible labeling of A can be realized by functions in H, then every possible labelings of any subset of A can also be realized by functions in H, which means if I have an m point subset of H that is shattered, then for every m prime which is less than m, there is a m prime point subset, at least one, namely an m prime point subset of that particular shattered set, which is shattered, okay. So, that is why we need to only look at the m, the largest m, for the highest cardinality set that is shattered, okay. So, this hence this definition, VC dimension is the cardinality of the largest shattered subset of X, is the same as what we saw earlier, that it is the value of m, the largest value of m, for which the maximum number of distinguishable functions grows as 2 power m, okay. So, now we can work with this. VC dimension is the cardinality of the largest shattered subset, right, because it is easier to find whether given set is shattered by H or not. So, let us sum the state this again, so that we fully understand. If we find at least one m point subset of X that is shattered, then we know that VC dimension is at least m, right. I can exhibit an m point subset that is shattered, then I know VC dimension cannot be less than that m. So, if I exhibit one m point subset of X that is shattered, then we can conclude that VC dimension is at least m. On the other hand, when I say this, we should also understand that not every m point subset need be shattered, because VC dimension is the over all possible m samples, what is the maximum number of distinguishable functions. So, if I can find at least one m point subset of X that is shattered, then I know VC dimension is at least m, but that does not mean that there are not, there can be, it certainly does not preclude there being other m point subsets that are not shattered, that does not concern us. So to show that VC dimension is at least m, we need to just exhibit one m point subset. Of course, there might be other, not every m point set may be shattered, but there will be at least one m point set that is shattered. On the other hand, to show that VC dimension is strictly less than m, we have to show that no m point set is shattered. Ultimately, to show that VC dimension is m, we should show at least one m point set that is shattered, and also have to show that no set containing m plus 1 points is shattered. Okay. That is how we can conclude that VC dimension is a particular integer. So, let us look at some examples of calculating VC dimension now. Let us go back to our old example. Our x is R2. And H is the axis family of axis parallel rectangles, right? Let us calculate what is the VC dimension of the family of axis parallel rectangles. We are going to show that the VC dimension of axis parallel rectangles happens to be 4. Okay. How can I show just from what I have just showed? To show that VC dimension is 4, we would exhibit at least one 4-point subset of R2 that is shattered by the family of axis parallel rectangles. And that no 5-point set can be shattered, right? This both of them I have to show before I can conclude that VC dimension is 4. To conclude that VC dimension is 4, I would exhibit at least one 4-point subset of R2 that is shattered by the family of axis parallel rectangles, and that no 5-point set can be shattered by this family. Okay? So this is what we are going to do. So we need to have some convention of when H takes value 1 and when it takes value 0. 1 and 0 are arbitrary. So, let us say our convention is that it takes value 1 on points inside and on the axis parallel rectangle and takes 0 on the points outside. Now, given a particular 4-point subset that is shattered, what does we have to show? For given any subset of these 4 points, on those subset it has to take value 1, on the rest of the set it has to take value 0. That is what shattered means. For every subset I have to do this. When will the axis parallel rectangle take value 1? If the points are inside. So, what it means is, for this particular 4-point set to be shattered, give me any subset of these 4 points, I can draw an axis parallel rectangle so that only that subset of points are inside the axis parallel rectangle and rest of them are outside the axis parallel rectangle. Now, what are the subsets I can take? 0, that is very easy, give me 4 points, I can put an axis parallel rectangle somewhere totally outside. Okay. And similarly, the subset that contains all of them also is fine, I can certainly put an axis parallel rectangle over them. So, you should consider subsets of 1, 2 and 3. So, any one point can be separated from the other 3, any 2 points can be separated from the other 2, and any 3 can be separated from the other 1. Separating 1 from 3 is same as 3 from 1. So, essentially we need to show 2 things. Given any 2 of the 4 points, there is an axis parallel rectangle that contains those 2 points but not the other 2. And similarly, given any 3 of the 4 points, there is an axis parallel rectangle that contains those 3 points but not the remaining ones. Okay. This is what I have to show that a specific 4-point set is shattered. So, this is an example. So, we just have to exhibit one 4-point set. So, let us exhibit one such set. Here is a 4-point set that is shattered. Okay. It is R2. So, I did not draw the axis. There is just any 4 points on the plane. So, I will show, we will currently see that 4-point set is shattered. What I am saying is, essentially you give me any subset. That means I am going to label these 2 as 1 and the other 2 as 0. That is what giving me a subset means. Then an element of my family of axis parallel rectangle that realizes that labeling is this axis parallel rectangle, because this element of my family takes value 1 on these 2 points and takes value 0 on these 2 points. Yeah. To really see that it is shattered, here is the full blow. So, if I want any 2, of course, there are 6 possible ways of choosing 2 from 4. I put in only 4 because already the diagram is cluttered. So, for example, I want to choose this and this point, then the blue axis parallel rectangle, okay, keep those 2 inside. On the other hand, if I want to take the other 2, this and this, the black one, that is the right. Similarly, the red one picks these 2, the green one picks these 2 and so on. Similarly, we can draw the remaining 2. Essentially, it is very easy to see now, once we draw this, I have put these 4 points so that each one has a unique x and y coordinate. So, at this x or y there is no other point, at this x or y there is no other point and so on. Once it is there, I can draw axis parallel rectangles enclosing any subset of them, right. It is intuitively very clear. Here is how I can do it for 3, right. There are only 4 ways of picking any 3 points, and all the four are exhibited here, right? All the different, all the four size 3 subsets of these 4 points are enclosed in each of these four axis parallel rectangles. So, this shows that this particular set of 4 points is shattered by the family of axis parallel rectangles. Of course, that this particular subset is shattered does not mean that every 4 point set is shattered, right? There can be other 4 points that are not shattered, right? For example, if you take these 3 points and put the 4th point anywhere, really does not matter, then that is not shattered. Just to show it is not shattered, I put a particular labeling. I want these two to be inside the rectangle and this not inside the rectangle, and these 3 are in a line. Because these 3 are in a line, it is impossible to put these 2 points inside an axis parallel rectangle which does not contain this. For example, any axis parallel rectangle that contains these two has to contain this. So, here is a 3 points of set that is not shattered, right? As a matter of fact, any 3 collinear points cannot be shattered by axis parallel rectangles, because this particular labeling cannot be realized by any axis parallel rectangle. I want this and this to be inside the rectangle, but this to be outside the rectangle, right? That is not possible. So, in the other 4 point subset we took, it is shattered because no 3 are on a line, but otherwise there can be 4 point subsets or even 3 point subsets that cannot be shattered. As we said, saying that VC dimension is at least M only means that there is one M point set that is shattered, not every M point set is shattered. So, now we know that the axis parallel rectangles have VC dimension at least M, okay. Now, to show that it is actually M, we need to show that no 5 point set can be shattered, okay. How do we argue this? Now, we cannot argue with an example, I have to say no 5 point set is shattered. So, consider any 5 point set where no 3 are collinear. Why? If any 3 of them are collinear, because I have to show this for every 5 point set, so how can I put restrictions? Take any 5 point set, if any 3 of them are collinear, I already know it cannot be shattered, because once 3 are collinear, it will be like this, right? No matter where you put the other 2 points, this particular labeling itself cannot be realized, so that 5 point set is not shattered. So, if any 3 points are collinear, anyway it cannot be shattered. So, take a 5 point set where no 3 are collinear. No 3 are collinear, then you find the maximum and minimum x and y coordinates among these 5 points. Because no 3 are collinear, a little thought will show you that there can be at most, there has to be at least 1 point in the interior of the rectangle formed by this max and min values. Once I find max x coordinate, min x coordinate, max y coordinate, min y coordinate, I can draw an axis parallel rectangle. Because all points are distinct and no 3 are collinear, at most 4 of them can be on the rectangle. The other one, its x and y coordinate, at least one of them has to be less than the max, and hence it has to be inside the rectangle. So, if I put the interior point as negative and the rest of them as positive, that means the rest of them should be inside the rectangle, but interior point should not be. Such a labeling cannot be realized, just like the 3 collinear thing. So, which means there is a 4 point subset that is shattered and no 5 point set is shattered, and hence VC dimension of axis parallel rectangles is 4. Okay. Here is a 5 point set that is and the labeling that can. So, if I take the max min x, min y, max y, so it is very easy to see that is the axis parallel rectangle I will draw, and hence there will be an interior point. If I label this as 0 and less of them as 1, such a labeling cannot be realized. So, we have shown that the VC dimension of the family of axis parallel rectangles is 4. Of course, it is also interesting that we need 4 parameters to represent this family. What do you mean by 4 parameters to represent this family? Any axis parallel rectangle can be specified by the coordinates of the bottom left and top right corner. Because axis parallel, if you give me the xy coordinates of the bottom left corner and the top right corner, axis parallel rectangle is completely specified. So, I just need 4 numbers to specify any one axis parallel rectangle. So, the entire family of axis parallel rectangles can be represented with 4 parameters. So, to learn a element of this family, I essentially need to learn the specific values of 4 parameters, and the VC dimension happens to be 4. Okay. In general, such a relationship between VC dimension and the number of parameters needed often holds. very often we see dimension is roughly same as the number of parameters needed to represent that class of functions. Of course, this is not always true. We can have a one parameter family of functions which has VC dimension infinity. For example, if I essentially consider all possible sine curves, right, essentially saying on, if I put a sense on the sine curve, on one side of the sine curve is positive, other side of the sine curve is negative, then a one parameter family give me sine curves of all possible frequencies. So, intuitively, if I put some points, I can essentially draw some sine curve with the other, keeping some points on one side and other points on the other. Okay. So, we will not consider that example right now, but just remember that it is not necessarily true that the VC dimension is equal to the number of parameters needed. As I am telling you, there is a one parameter family of functions whose VC dimension is finite. But very often, the number of parameters you have to learn an element of that family is equal to the VC dimension. And in that sense, once again, it is very satisfying that VC dimension is the complex. If you have to learn many more parameters, obviously the learning problem is more complex. Okay. To complete, since VC dimension is finite, we know for this axis parallel rectangle problem, empirical disk minimization is consistent. So, if our algorithm finds the global minimize of empirical disk, then given enough examples, the true risk of that classified will also be close to the global minimum of true risk. In particular, that is why it is pack learnable, right. In the pack framework, there is no noise. So, the global minimum possible for empirical disk will be 0, because there is always some function in my family that is consistent with all examples. So, if you give me any global minimizer of empirical risk, that means any classifier that classifies all examples correctly, that is good enough. Actually, earlier when we considered, we said give me the smallest axis parallel rectangle that encloses all the Poiteux examples. We need not have said that. Now, we know once all the three. An algorithm that gives me either the smallest axis parallel rectangle that encloses all the Poiteux examples, or the largest axis parallel rectangle that does not enclose any negative examples, or anything in between. Essentially, as long as my algorithm returns a axis parallel rectangle that classifies all the examples correctly, that algorithm pack learns, because given enough examples, it will be close to the the global minimizer of true risk. That is what VC dimension finite means. VC dimension is finite, unlike in packs and there is no noise, then anything that does well on data will do well. Anything that classifies all the examples correctly will also have very small test error. In particular, if there is no noise, of course, if there is noise, then also it is true in the sense anything whose empirical risk is sufficiently small will have its true risk also sufficiently small. If the number of examples is large enough, how large is large? Large relative to the VC dimension. Okay. Now, let us consider the other example. See, when we considered that, we had the other extreme example, where instead of taking x parallel rectangles, we have taken all possible two class classifiers on x. So, every possible subset of x is in H. When I say H is equal to 2 power x, essentially means every binary valued function on x is in my family H. As we seen, this is too flexible, we cannot learn. So, we should expect VC dimension to be infinity here. We will show that it is infinity. What does H equal to 2 power x means? You give me any subset B of x, x is R2, so give me any subset of R2, because H contains every subset. Essentially, what it means is there is a function in H which takes value 1 only for points in B and 0 outside. So, for every subset B of x, there is a function H, right? I can call it HB, which is the characteristic function of that set B actually, which takes value 1 for all x in B and value 0 outside. What is my shattering definition? Given a set A that is shattered, if for every subset B of A, there is a H that takes value 1 on B, 0 in A minus B, and outside A, I do not care. Now, given any subset B, whether subset of A or not, there is a function that takes 1 only for points in B. That is what we have just now seen, right. So, which means, because we have this, give me any finite set, it is shattered by this family. Because give me any finite set A, give me any subset B of A, then there is a function that takes value exactly 1 and B and 0 elsewhere. So, 0 and A minus B, which means every finite subset is shattered here. So, because every finite subset is shattered, the VC dimension is infinite, and obviously we cannot learn, right? As we already seen, there is no generalization possible if I try to learn with this thing, and that also comes through because this particular H has VC dimension infinity, okay. So, essentially what we have done is, what the essence of the theory that we have presented so far is, minimizing empirical risk is good if R at NH converges to R H uniformly over H. The uniform convergence holds if VC dimension of H is finite, and VC dimension also gives us an idea of the complexity of the family H, okay. We have seen some examples. Essentially, complexity means if the VC dimension is high, then we need correspondingly large number of examples to have confidence that low empirical risk means low true risk, because the true risk of any H can be bounded above by its empirical risk plus a model complexity term, which goes to 0 as VC dimension by the number of examples. So, if the number of examples is sufficiently larger relative to the VC dimension, then we can have sufficient confidence that low empirical risk means low true risk, right. In this sense, it also tells us, gives us an idea of the complexity of the learning problem. We have considered only the two class classifiers so far. Everything that we define, all the functions we consider are binary valued functions on X. Only for this case, we found bounding, we bounded the annihilation error and defined VC dimension, right. For example, the shattering, the way we define, does not even make sense if H is, for example, real valued function on X, okay. Then what labeling is realized or not realized, how can we say? We will just state that, as we already know, the risk minimization framework is more general, right. We do not have to take functions H to be X to 0 1 or X to even the class labels. We can take X to R also, right. We have seen that even discriminant functions can be included in the risk minimization framework. So, as it turns out, everything that we did about the VC theory, about VC dimension, about this need for empirical risk to converge to true risk uniformly over H for empirical discrimination to be consistent on the notion of VC dimension, all this can be extended to family of real valued functions over X. So, the extension is both conceptually as well as notationally complex. It needs a lot more knowledge of real analysis and so on. So, we are not even attempting it. So, we will just state that this can be extended to general functions on X also. Having said that, we'll still look at two class classifier functions. One important class of two class classifiers that we considered are hyperplane classifiers, the so called linear classifiers made out of linear discriminant functions. This is important for us later on also in the course when we look at what are called kernel based methods. So, here each two class classifier is essentially a hyperplane in RD. One side of the hyperplane is one, the other side of the hyperplane is the other. As it turns out, in D dimension, the VC dimension of the hyperplane is D plus 1. Since the hyperplane classifiers are very important to us, we will also learn how to actually show that the VC dimension of hyperplane classifiers is D plus 1 in the next class. Thank you.